introduce a man who's familiar to all of us. On behalf of the community services industry here in Tasmania today, we'd like to welcome you here, Premier, to this gathering of industry leaders. Thank you.
Adrian, thank you for inviting me on today. Could I begin firstly by acknowledging and paying my respects to the Tasmanian Aboriginal people as the ongoing custodians of the land on which we gather today, and acknowledge elders past, present and emerging. Just on that, I want to say, like, you know, one of the things I think we have to do in our community as we move forward, and I've said this a few times since Australia Day, we all acknowledge country, but we actually need to really mean it. And I think, as I said, post-Australia Day, I think it's time that we did have a conversation, a national conversation, in terms of what Australia Day looks like in this country and how we can all move forward and all enjoy it together. And importantly, changing the date is something that we need to consider, and I think we should do that. I especially thank Adrian for the invitation. I'd like to acknowledge Alex McKenzie as the chair, and obviously welcome all of you here today. The last time I spoke at this event was back in November 2019. For those of you that were there, I don't think Tom was with us today. I made the point that I'm a lot different to what the Mercury might draw me up in a cartoon, or what Tom Lynch might say about me publicly. And I tried to provide just a little bit of background then. But who would have known that today I'd be standing here as Premier, more importantly, that all of us together have managed through a pandemic over the last 12 months. And I want to sincerely thank you for all of that. Now, interestingly enough, when I spoke back in November, Tasmania was riding an all-time economic high. We had the fastest growing economy in the country. It was growing three times faster than New South Wales at the time. Then obviously we've had to deal with the pandemic and the impacts of that, which hit us in March of last year. Difficult decisions had to be taken, difficult decisions that impacted on all Tasmanians in some way. Services shut down, businesses closed, and for a period of time Tasmanians were asked to stay home to save lives, and I'm so very thankful that they did hear that message and that they did stay home and they did stay home, save lives. Now, as a result of those changes and those directions that we introduced, retail trade by April, a month later, had fallen by nearly 20%. By May of last year, 20,000 Tasmanians had lost their jobs. Nearly 30% of those jobs were in the hospitality sector. In June of last year, Treasury were forecasting that our unemployment rate would reach around 12.5%. Now, during these uncertain times, we moved to provide as much certainty as we possibly could. And as a state, I'm proud that, when we needed to make decisions, we did, informed by advice. We moved first on cruise ships. The rest of the country followed us shortly thereafter. We closed our borders with the first state. And I remember, I was just saying, the national conversation that I was having with my colleagues, who none of them were in support of that. But I'd argued very strongly that I thought that as a federation, we had the same characteristics as a ship with watertight compartments, and that what we should do is where the virus was either at most risk or where it was most prevalent, that we should be free to close our borders. Now, we decided to go it alone. Interestingly enough, within weeks, most other jurisdictions have followed us. We used our strong balance sheet at the same time as well as an economic stabiliser. We delivered more than $1 billion in support, the largest social and economic support package out of all of the states as a percentage of their overall economies. That's, I think, without doubt, helped our people, it's helped our communities, and it's helped our businesses to be able to restart again and to get back up and running. Last year, I announced a $3.1 billion construction blitz. Now, I'm firmly of the view that whilst not all of our jobs that we've lost or that we need to replace are in the construction sector, I'm firmly of the view, and all of the economic modelling that I've ever looked at indicates that this is correct, is that if you can stimulate the construction, and especially civil and housing construction, then the supply chain is so long that aggregate demand lifts right across your economy. And we're starting to see that with some extraordinary outcomes across our retail sectors now, and also in our cafes and restaurant sector. We announced a $5 billion infrastructure package late last year with the late budget, which will stand us in good stead and importantly provide that pipeline moving forward for our businesses. Now, I wanted to just touch on, when I was here as Treasurer, you know, I would have pointed to the fact that we had one of the strongest financial positions that the state had been in, a very strong balance sheet. Make the point that, you know, as Treasurer, when we were aiming for surpluses, it wasn't to win a gold medal. You aim for surpluses so that you can improve your balance sheet, so that when you need it, it's there for you to use. And what we were able to do was to use that strong balance sheet strength when we needed it to actually put record amounts of investment, of support back into our communities. Now, and importantly, you know, as Premier and as Treasurer, you know, if we needed to do it again, you know, I'd act in a heartbeat, because I think that, you know, the green shoots that we're seeing now, the positivity that's starting to emerge, is largely as a result of the heavy lifting that was done by those with the balance sheets able to do it at the time, which was the federal government, the state governments. We couldn't expect the corporate sector to do that. Their people were at home, their businesses weren't operating. In fact, in some cases, they're still not. Now, noting the challenges we all face to ensure that there's meaningful work for people, as well as housing Tasmanians appropriately, it's pleasing to see that the pipeline is really starting to fill up. I just want to touch on a couple of statistics, and I won't spend a great deal of time on these today, but what's interesting in housing, I think, is so important. I think we all understand that in this room. Dwelling approvals have risen in December last year, 66.5%. 66.5% increase on where they were 12 months earlier. That means that we've got more houses being planned to be built. It was the largest monthly increase in the country, and more than six times the national growth rate. So our early strategy is to build our way to recovery in terms of ensuring that that pipeline is there, that we can actually get houses out of the ground, is starting to come to fruition. Importantly, more than 80% of Tasmanians have now returned to work since the height of the pandemic in May, and importantly, our participation rate, those that are out there looking for work, has started to increase as well. It fell quite dramatically early on for obvious reasons. I must admit, I'm confident in the year ahead, because importantly, I think the resilience and strength of the Tasmanian people will once again, in the same way that we're able to deal with the pandemic, will come through as we start to rebuild. It's testament to the character of Tasmanians that we've come so far so soon. Yesterday I released the mid-year update in terms of the budget position, and that has started to improve itself, and importantly, the Treasury forecasts, and I must say, I'll say this with the, if they were in the room or not, like, I've got a very conservative Treasury. They are black hats, and they wear them well. but they have stood the state in good stead, and largely as a result of their advice, we had that strong balance sheet and were able to use it as and when we needed it. But importantly, they have started to revise up their economic forecasts quite dramatically, both in terms of the growth in our economy, but also the number of jobs that are going to be created. And I think that stands us in very good stead moving forward. The increasing economic activity is now being underpinned on an ongoing basis by growing consumer and business confidence. Retail trade is up, the housing investment I've spoken about across the state, supported by the Home Builder Program, and I'll touch on a couple of numbers in relation to that shortly, has just been extraordinary in terms of the number of properties that are being built at the moment. And importantly, with the budget strengthening, that will mean that we will have the revenues that we need to ensure that we can continue to invest in the service sector and we can continue to support our community fully. Now, one of the things that I do want to point to very clearly is that how we support people moving forward, because there have been challenges. We were just talking about it a moment ago here in terms of the mental health challenge that we have in front of us. That is going to be something that all of us in this room are going to need to engage in, and as a community we're going to have the most forthright conversation in a safe way with our community as we move forward to ensure that we stop as many people as we possibly can from falling through the cracks. Now, In terms of the steps that we took, living on an island, which was at times has been described as our biggest disadvantage, became very quickly our most important advantage. And last year, and over the last 12 months, one of the things that I came to realise was the strength of the Tasmanian character. It was a year where we witnessed an outpouring of goodwill, of kindness, of compassion. As Tasmanians, we demonstrated a common humanity, a greater sense of community than I've ever witnessed during my lifetime. Now, regardless of background, regardless of race, regardless of politics, regardless of circumstance, in the last 12 months, Tasmanians held out their hands to each other in ways that I've never before witnessed. I'll just share a couple of examples. I had an elderly lady, she was 90, had called my office just to pass on something that she was really surprised about. And I rang her back and spoke to her, and she said, look, she said, I've lived next to the migrant, in her words, the migrant Asian family next door for more than a decade. We've passed each other's as we walked to the street, and we've never said anything more than hello or a nod. She said, I couldn't tell you their names. The day that we locked the state down, they were on her front doorstep, asking her whether or not she wanted them to shop for her. Could they bring her anything? Now, that is just such an example of the way that our community came together, that we did the little things, that we supported each other. And as Premier, as a Tasmanian, I could not be prouder of the way that Tasmanians stood up through this, and they helped each other, and we got through it, I think, better than most other jurisdictions. And importantly, right now, we are one of the safest places in this country, if not one of the safest places in the world. And that is because Tasmanians did what was needed to be done, but importantly, they held out their hand to each other and they worked together. I want to especially thank the community sector through this. The organisations that you represent together with the employees, your volunteers, have been one of the shining lights in my view. And I think when I came in November the year before last and spoke, I think that was the first time as Treasurer in my 6 years that I'd actually engaged with the sector in a meaningful way. I tried to explain a little bit about my background and who I was and some of the thinking that I had. But I must say, over the last 12 months, I have really come to understand the extent of the work that you do and the need for the work that you do. To see the way that your sector pivoted and found new ways to work in delivering services to the most vulnerable, at a time when people were anxious, when they were frightened, when they were fearful, now people in this room stepped up and they helped those Tasmanians through what was a very difficult period. I look at, on a monthly basis, 150,000 kilograms of fresh food being delivered. The migrants communities that you supported, one of the proudest things that I did through the pandemic was after the federal government had left a significant gap in support for migrants, I took the view after spending Sunday at home with my kids that if my children were somewhere else on this planet, the other side of the world when this hit, I would have wanted someone to hold out their hand to them. And so we were the first state to put in place, albeit meagre, albeit we didn't fill the gap completely, but the first government to actually reach out its hand to our migrant communities and say that the pandemic grants are available to you that will provide support, that if you're a family you can have up to $1,000, if you're an individual, $250, and if you get into further trouble, let us know. Because as a community, we needed to support each other. As a community, I felt that we had a responsibility. And I'm so pleased that we did that. And as I say, it's one of the proudest things that one of the matters that I'm proudest of. But all of you went above and beyond, working to find ways that would see services to continue, see services delivered to those who needed it most. And I'm really proud that as a government, and as a Liberal government, and probably not the best fit for the community sector, But I found that last year we worked together in a way that I don't think any government has ever worked with the community sector, and together we delivered outcomes for Tasmanians that have ensured that not only did we save lives, but we improved lives through what was a very, very difficult period. And I'm forever thankful for that, and you should all be very proud of the work that you did. I'm very proud of the steps that you took and very thankful of that. And importantly, I'll just talk about this year a little bit. And as I've gone through this, I've done my very best not to sugarcoat anything. And this is going to be a challenging year. There's no two ways about that. I've got great confidence in Tasmania's future, but 2021 is going to be a year that's going to have its ups and downs, and it's going to have ebbs and flows, and it will have challenges. We have been very fortunate in our response to the virus. Some of the early actions that we took, and again, I was just saying at my table here, and my advice to any Premier that ends up in a similar position to me in the future would be to ensure that you've got a very conservative, a very sensible, a very responsible public health director that stands behind you. The work of Dr. Veach and his team has been outstanding. Some of it a little difficult to understand at times, and things like dancing and other things have caused me no end of grief. It is interesting, I'll just make this point. I was looking back at the last pandemic that we dealt with, which was the Spanish flu, and they banned dancing then as well. It must be the devil's work for some reason. But as we move forward, the challenge that we're going to have, and we'll be rolling out what will be our greatest safeguard and our best opportunity, and that's the vaccination program. And that rollout will be the single largest health logistical exercise in this country's history and in the state's history. Now, it won't be a silver bullet, but it will be our strongest shield. And importantly, as we move forward, we're going to learn more about what the vaccine's capable of. At this point in time, I couldn't tell you whether it will last 6 months, 12 months, 2 years, or five. This is brand new. What we know is that it's safe. But just how long it will actually provide that safety for, we don't know, and so there may be a need to come back and go through it all again relatively quickly. But the most important thing is, as we work through this, and I know that I'll get your commitment on this, I need to know if there are people falling through the cracks. Now, we've rolled out a program that prioritises those who are at highest risk first, and those that are most vulnerable. People are falling through the cracks, let the government know. We need to work together on this. It's going to be so important that we can deliver this with confidence, that people feel comfortable taking it, and importantly, that we get to the areas that we must. Now, at the moment, the schedule looks quite reasonable to me. The first Pfizer hub will be up and running from Monday here in Hobart. We'll then move and establish a second Pfizer hub at the LGH and then up in the northwest. We'll then start the AstraZeneca, or once the TGA has approved it, with a broader rollout as well. But importantly, we're going to need to work together, and we're going to need to communicate. And at the end of the day, as I've said, I don't want people to fall through the cracks, so ensure that we communicate regularly. Now, the other focus that I'm going to have this year is going to be to ensure that we continue to rebuild, that we continue to take the steps forward. Our economy is looking stronger. Our jobs are coming back. Our forecast is good. It is important, though, that we all remember that the reason that we are in a good place is that we've all done the right things. And we're going to need to continue to do those right things for a while now, moving forward. Make certain that we have good hand hygiene. Make certain that we socially distance. Make certain that we... if there are rules that are brought in place at different times to manage outbreaks in other states, that we do our very best to follow those rules, because it's going to be important that we continue with the momentum that we've got. Now, importantly, rebuilding will not just be about bricks and mortar. Rebuilding also means building on the community connectedness that we've witnessed during the past year, building our support networks, our communications, our partnerships, working together for the good of the state as we move forward, ensuring that we can provide the services that Tasmanians need, and I know from Paul I made a note in terms of oral care. Going, it was challenging, but I didn't realise it was that challenging, and I note that we've created more of a problem as a result of the shutdowns that we've had as well. And so I'd be very pleased to work with you on that when it's ready. Importantly, coming up in the next month, we should receive the PESRAC report. Now, I've allowed that process to be conducted completely unfettered from government. I don't know what's going to be in it. I know that we've had a significant engagement with the community sector, but also with other sectors as well. I have great faith in the people that are on that board. They are broadly representative of our community, both the sectors, industry and community, but regionally as well. And I'm certain that we will see a very sensible body of work that I'm hoping that we can work together on to ensure that we can lay down the pathway to an even stronger Tasmania as a result. That will, as I say, be available in the next month, I expect. Now, the other matters that we'll work on as well this year, Tasmania's first ever whole of government comprehensive child and youth wellbeing strategy. Tanya, I think this is a fantastic initiative, but it was driven out of your sector, and I just think that that is such an important building block that we need to put in place. Now, healthcare, we've started a process there with Sarah Courtney, and I'd just make the point, if you get an opportunity to see it, she was there every step of the way, especially when we were, we ran almost 70 days straight when we had the Northwest outbreak, has done a fantastic job. Is a very, very good and engaged minister, and I'm forever thankful that she was there supporting the team and being a part of it as we worked our way through. But make certain that you get to know her. She's a very clear thinker in terms of where she wants to take healthcare in this state. Importantly, we want to ensure that we're giving the right treatment in the right place at the right time. Now, it's a throwaway line, but it is so important, and it's one that we want to really drive home as a mantra as we move forward. And I've touched on mental health already, because that is going to be one of the most significant challenges that we face. I've got at this point in time, if I could make this point, like I felt anxious throughout this period. Now, I felt fear. I'm sure you in this room have felt exactly the same thing as well. I'm sure that your clients have, people that you know, your family and friends, different times. Now, this was a virus that, at its peak in Victoria, was killing 3 out of every 10 people that it impacted on in an aged care sector. Now, we have an older and more vulnerable population. I know that they have been anxious. I know that our healthcare workers have been anxious. Now, I spent time at the Northwest Regional Hospital, called in there quietly after we'd reopened again. And to understand the fear that they had felt, especially those in the ED, the first responders, not knowing who they would have to deal with, but not just in terms of the very difficult health challenges that present, but also that whether COVID was going to be part of their working environment that day. They have done an outstanding job, but there will be impacts, and we will need to work with our first responders, our police. Now, you look at Darren Hine and the job that he has done, again, you couldn't have a better police commissioner for a challenge like this that we've had to face. But Tasmania Police have, their job largely is to support the community and lock up the crooks. What they've had to do is to police our community. Now, they've been responsible for compliance checking, for not making certain that people don't go to their shacks. Now, we had helicopters in the air. There have been challenges that we have felt right across the sector. If you look at our community and our business sector, the challenges that they face with the lockdowns, the loss of income, the loss of businesses, it's going to be difficult, it's going to be challenging, but as I've said, we need to have that open and safe conversation. We need to think about how we do that, because I think that the level of anxiety in our community is probably more than what we could ever imagine as a result of what we've been through. We're going to look at, as we move forward, tailored employment solutions. Again, with strategic growth and Sarah Courtney, we've got the Sorrel Employment Hub that's working together, and how we can work with communities on these local solutions that we're looking for. Now, I said when I first stood up last year and I was at my first press conference as Premier that I wanted to lead a government of conviction, that I wanted to lead a government of compassion, that I wanted to lead a government that regardless of who you were, regardless of where you come from or what your circumstances are, that you will be able to grasp the opportunity that's presented in this state. And I feel really passionate about that. And I think, now Adrian, you touched on it, local communities know best how to solve these challenges, and we need to engage with local communities. We need to engage with you that are coalface, and we need to ensure that we're having those conversations about getting the best outcomes that we can. I want to touch briefly on housing, and I want to just talk about it and just paint a picture at the moment, because I think this is a significant challenge and an issue that we have to deal with. Now, we all understand the security it provides, we all understand the comfort it provides, we all understand the economic benefit, the jobs that it provides during its construction. There's always more to be done. The fact is, there are more homes being delivered right now today than ever before in this state. But I just want to touch on some numbers to give you a picture. In the 2020 calendar year, there were 3,473 dwellings approved. And that's the highest number of dwellings that we've ever approved in this state in a 12-month period in more than a quarter of a century. Give you a sense of scale of this, Tasmania normally builds around 2,800 houses a year. And so the approvals pipeline coming through is significantly in excess of what we've ever had to deal with before. In the September quarter last year, Tasmania had the second highest growth in new housing commencements. So houses coming out of the ground in the country growing 7% in the quarter. And I want to touch on home builder, because a lot of people said to me, home builder and private houses, there's a big divide between that and social and affordable housing. But I must admit, I think the two go together. And the reason I say that is this, that if we're building homes, not necessarily first homes, and first homes was a separate set of numbers for that, but if we're building new homes, for people that currently are either in rented accommodation or in their own home, that's going to free up twofold the supply once that new property is built. And I think what we will see is a significant increase in housing begin to emerge over the latter parts of this year as these new properties come out of the ground. In terms of the Home Builder Program, we've had or in fact in the first 2 weeks of January, more than 600 additional applications came through. Now, they are for, not first homes, but for a new home, and they will open up, as I say, other properties as well. The market will start to balance itself in terms of supply and demand. We will start to see, I hope, over time, downward pressure on housing prices, and importantly, a slowing of rental increases. But the only way that we can do that is to get houses built and to get as many out of the ground as possible. Now, on top of the home builder and the first home builder programs that we run, the government's also obviously rolling out its $100 million program that we announced last year in terms of social and affordable housing. That's part of the $300 million program that'll roll out over the next couple of years. But in terms of that, in the last week, we've announced the first 760 odd homes have been contracted to be built with the community housing sector. That's in fact interesting enough, spread across 20 local government areas. Now I'm determined that as a government we will build more houses, we will build them as quickly as we can, and importantly if we increase that supply across the board, we will house more Tasmanians appropriately than ever before. But what I would like to know and understand from the sector, and one of the things that does disappoint me, is that we end up arguing in the press over this. Now, if there are issues, if there are things that we can do better, if we can do it quicker, then contact me, contact my minister, let's work out what we can do. I want to work on solutions. Now, we're as determined as you are to ensure that we can provide the comfort, the security that housing provides. If there are shortfalls, there are areas that need attention, let me know. Now, moving ahead and in conclusion, as I've said, it won't be business as usual this year. It's going to be challenging, and there will be ebbs and flows, and there will be difficult times. I'm certain that we will have to face. You've only got to look at what's happened with Victoria in the last little while. This is a highly contagious virus. Now, we've had good people working very hard, and we've got on top of this, and we've had just enough luck. I'm a great believer that the harder you work, the luckier you get, and so we'll continue to work very hard, and hopefully that luck will work with us. But this is challenging, and we need to ready ourselves at some stage. There may be an outbreak in the state. Now, I'm hoping that we can keep on top of it. I think that we've got one of the best entry programs in the country in terms of getting into Tasmania. Now, we'll have, as we step forward, I guess in terms of my closing comments today, we want to work with you. We understand the value of the sector. It's important that as we move forward, and with a late budget this year, that there is sustainability, that you've got the security moving forward. It would be my intention that where we have contracts that are ending at the end of the year, those that would be normally rolled over as part of the May budget process, that we will put in place those contracts early so that you've got security moving forward. I'll take questions in a moment, but I just want to finish on this. Thank you so much for the work that you've done. I know so many Tasmanians have had their lives improved, and the assistance that you provided over the last 12 months, especially as we've worked through this, you know, has stood this state in great stead. Your support to those communities that have required it, have needed it, you know, has just been a blessing at this particular time. So thank you. I couldn't be prouder of both the work that you've done, nor the engagement the government has had with your sector, and importantly, what I think is a strong partnership that we've built moving forward. So thank you. You should all be very proud of yourself, and I'll take any questions. Actually, I'm sort of running the show, and I shouldn't have.
You're allowed. You're the premier. You can do what
you want. I think I am taking questions.
You are taking questions. I was just going to say thank you. I think certainly hearing you talk about how much you've grown in your understanding of the community services industry and the importance of the work that we do, I think is really heartening and reassuring for all of us here in this room. And you know, the fact that you're so committed to wanting to work on solutions, I think that's what we're all about here. Which is great. And also just, you know, the acknowledgement of the collaboration, as I mentioned that in my speech, but it's certainly something that we hear a lot right across the sector, how important that collaboration was between government and the not-for-profit industry as well. And yeah, just so that, and that leaving no one behind. I mean, I think that's really what we're about, making sure everybody has access to the opportunities we have here in Tasmania. So as the Premier mentioned, we have got some time now for questions, which is great. If you have a question for Venya, when you get the microphone, if you could say your name and the organisation that you're representing as well.
Hi, Mike Chisholm. Thanks, Premier, for coming back to talk to us. We missed the stories about your family and what your kids think about you, but hopefully that is the hero of COVID Tasmania. I'm here representing the National Disability Services, which is a big body for disability organisations. We recently confirmed a position about vaccination in the community sector, or in our sector, confirming that we believe it probably should be a mandatory vaccination for people working in care. As vexed an issue as that is, I suppose our concern is we can't socially distance when we're providing personal care. We know from the research internationally that people with a disability are probably twice as likely to die from COVID if they're exposed. And we know that probably, however safe we are, our biggest risk to our clients and our staff bringing an infection into the house. So for that reason, and absolutely thank you for prioritising disability and aged care, right, literally first cabs off the rank almost. But we do have probably staff who are uncertain, and we'll work with our staff to support them. But at the end of the day, we will have some staff who will refuse to be vaccinated. And one of the discussions, I suppose, in our sector is the IR solution to that is really difficult. And I know the federal government in our discussions nationally have said they're quite sure the states would be more than happy to provide a public health order to require workers to be vaccinated. So I'm just wondering where the government's thinking is on what I acknowledge is a very vexed and moral issue, I suppose.
Look, it's one that, it'd be fair to say, that is exercising our mind at the moment. The challenge is, and it's an easy one, and it'd be an easy position for me to take publicly, that, you know, if you work with at-risk people, if you're a healthcare worker more broadly across one of our hospitals, that it'll be mandatory to take the jab. The challenge is that you can't hold anyone down and force them to take it, and if they don't want it, then you run the risk of actually having a depleted workforce. And so, whilst it's an option, and certainly under the directions powers that we have, across all of the states and territories, our public health director could mandate, we want to work and encourage people to see whether or not we can get that coverage above the 80% figure, which is broadly speaking where they tell me we've got to be in terms of vaccinations, and see if people will do it willingly to begin with. What will be really important, I think in the sector, where we can is those people that would be respected to take the jab as well as early as possible in the process, whether in individual organisations or even at the state government level. Like, I think I'll be one of the first that will be getting jabbed. We need to demonstrate that this is safe. Everything that I've read, everything I've been advised on indicates that is absolutely the case. As I say, the only question is how long it will last. But the mandatory issue is certainly something that we are thinking deeply about, and as you rightly touched on, there are some ethical issues, but there are mechanisms that we could use if we needed to get that on, to get to that point. I'm hoping that we don't get to that point where we need to exercise a direction.
We've got Sharon, and then we've got Sharon
Hochtel, State Director of Red Cross. Red Cross internationally and nationally are specialists in planning and delivering on community-led recovery after emergency and disasters. Recently, we've seen Red Cross take a lead role internationally in the response to the pandemic, and also nationally in recovery from last summer's bushfires. Locally in Tasmania, we've leveraged from this experience to build our capability to support and mobilise communities through this COVID experience. We've seen a range of community consultation and feedback, including through PEDSRAC, has shown that communities want to take control of building resilience and leading local recovery. My question is, if you could expand on the comments that you made in your speech and share your thoughts on how we can put communities in Tasmania in the driver's seat as the decision makers to build resilience and reduce disaster risk from the bottom up.
Well, look, as part of that, Sharon, thank you for that question, and thank you for the very good work that Red Cross does. I know that as we work our way through this, there's been some exceptional work that's been done, so thank you. But one of the key things I think we've got to look at, and it is interesting in terms of Tasmania, and it's patchy. There are some communities that I've been to that have never done as well. The East Coast, for example, is just in an extraordinary positive position at the moment. The Northwest, I think, there are challenges. Their economy is coming back, and I think it's relatively positive, but you can't put 5,000 people into quarantine as we did, and you can't shut down hospitals and have that level of messaging in terms of ensuring that people understood the concern that government felt about the virus without it having an impact. And so, I think it'll be important through each local community to tailor local solutions, as I've said, but it will be the engagement piece that's important. Now, at the moment, the engagement piece with government is local government. I think that we've got to think about how we can reach below that and how we can establish better networks to ensure that we are hearing, importantly, messages from the coalface in those communities. Work's underway at the moment. DPAC are looking at those sorts of mechanisms. And I know that PEDRAC's got a very strong view as well as to how we might get that in place.
My name is Lucy McCann, I'm the general manager of the Smith family in Tasmania. And my question really sort of reflects Adrian's comments at the beginning around digital inclusion. And so you'd be very familiar with Tasmania's ranking in the Australian Digital Inclusion Index. And it's been great to see his ranking report that the need to recognise digital inclusion as a, an essential service, just like power and water, was clearly stated. And before that, in the task force report. And for the Smith family, we've been working for over 21 years to provide digital inclusion packages for families and children who are particularly disadvantaged in that area. And so we've developed an expertise around the complex relationship between digital exclusion, poverty, and education outcomes, just as many of my colleagues in the room have in the sectors that they work in, whether that's in relation to the age or disability areas. And so my question to you is, really, would you like to see something developed along the lines of some targets for digital inclusion, particularly for the most vulnerable members of our Tasmanian community, and perhaps something along the lines of sort of tying it to those measures within the Australian Digital Inclusion Index, so that, and perhaps here really sort of reflecting on something Paul talked about in terms of the power of partnerships, so that we've got something that we can all really, you know, be pulling towards and aiming for.
Well, look, Lizzie, thank you for that question. Look, it surprises me that that data's not already available, that we could build off to set those targets. So, look, I'd be happy to engage on that and through my Human Services Minister to get some understanding of what his view is. But, look, I'm a Treasurer first before a Premier. Like, I love targets, believe me. So I think if there's no point aiming for something if you don't know what you're aiming for. So look, I'd be happy to have a further conversation. I'd like to get some information back from my minister in terms of what he believes is going on in that space at the moment. First up, that's okay.
So Julie,
and
being here today,
Julie
Dunn Madden from the Tasmanian Schools Tennessee Association. During COVID, we did have schools preparing ready-to-eat meals for families that were struggling, and we worked closely with organisations such as Loaves and Fishes. And we were very lucky to receive some funding last term to trial a lunch school lunch program for three schools, and we've got some great results coming out of that, which I'd love to share with you once I've got the report from Menzies. I think one of the things that we saw was that there was a mismatch in access to food, yet we had lots of producers growing food, and that food isn't going into our schools. And my question to you is, how can we actually bolster the food growing industry to also be linked to feeding our children well and for them to enjoy our Tasmanian food?
Well, Julie, look, and thank you again, and thanks for the work that you're doing. Good to see you again. I think we're out of Glenorchy. We were, that's right. I think we fixed the problem, did we?
Yes, we did.
Good one. Excellent. Yeah. So I hadn't followed that up, but I knew that when you mentioned that there was an issue there, so we got on good. Oh, there's no mystery. It was just to do with the van, wasn't it? The food van issue. Yeah, we got that sorted. Look, I think that would be a really important conversation to have. Obviously, you know, there's we have both the primary production sector and the commercial operations, and then we have community gardens as well. But in terms of having that conversation about how we could better link and provide food into the schools, I think I'd be very happy to have that discussion. I think we all understand the value of nutrition. And I've had the benefit of being married to an early childhood teacher, or a former early childhood teacher, who is very, very keen to remind me of the challenges that that many of the families that she used to teach face, and many of the kids would face as well. So, look, I'd be happy to have that conversation. I think one of the things, and again, it's about one of the beautiful things about where we've all come from through this, I think there is a desire at the moment and a willingness for people to connect and have these types of conversations. So once you've got some data from the trial and we can work through my office, I'd be very happy to engage in that.
We'll have that on Friday.
Okay. I'd be very pleased to look at it very quickly.
Thank you. We've got Deb, then we've got John, and then somebody from
certainly Adrian and Paul today talked about looking to the not-for-profit sector and particularly to looking to people with lived experience around solutions. Something that's perplexed me for the long time that I've worked within the community sector is why government in many instances doesn't do the same. So if I can give you a couple of examples, a project that worked with people with brain injury and families coming out of hospital into that into the community, in a 10-month period we got some very good outcomes for over 170 people. We went to the health minister with some demonstrated cost savings, some demonstrated benefits around reducing carer burden and getting good outcomes for people with brain injury. To get the project funded, his response was, "Deb, this is disability, you need to go and talk to the disability minister." We went and spoke to the disability minister, we gave some really good examples, and she said, "Deb, we can't fund this because you're working from the hospital, this is a health issue." Currently, at the moment, we have people with brain injury that are ending up in the prison because health, justice and disability can't determine who would fund a liaison, court liaison position through the diversion court. So we have people in prison at a far greater cost than actually funding the position. So I guess my question to you is, at that higher level policy, how do we get government to work together to come to work with the community around some of these solutions? Because if we can't get government to work together and stop the silos and the demarcation, I think it doesn't matter how much work we do in terms of trying to get those outcomes.
Well, Deb, thank you for that. Look, and the first thing I would say is that I think we all want the same outcomes, and obviously if there is an issue there, then it's something we can look into. I'd make the point, it's been a while since we've had a male health minister, so that must have been under another premier. So I'll leave that. That's how he ran the government. I might run it a bit differently. Look, I'd be very keen in seeing some of that information that you provided. It does surprise me, and knowing who both the health minister was back then and the disability minister, that you didn't get better engagement. That does surprise me. But look, I would. I'm more than happy to raise that matter and have them. Have the new ministers have a look at it and that issue, because at the end of the day, as I said when I started, I'm sure we all want the same outcomes. If there is something that's falling through the gaps, you know, I've learnt a long time ago that, and I think it was Deming that said, you know, if things aren't happening as you want it to happen, you know, don't look at your people, look at your processes and see what the issue is. So if there's a process issue there, I'm more than happy to have a look at it and see what we can do. But as I say, I'm sure we want the same outcomes.
So I've got John, and then I'm handing over to you.
Premier, I just want to say my wife works in public health, and we lost her for 6 months from February to September. And so I want to reiterate what's been said, that knowing Mark and Scott and the fact that they could go to work knowing you had their back and you support, you listened to the advice and acted on the advice, that's no small thing. And so we're very, very grateful for that. And I can't name her because she'd be in trouble, but name one or two. I just want to put on, the CEO of the Nils Network of Tasmania, and something we're very aware of, and one of my board members is in the room, and I blow a hole in our KPIs if the government takes this step, but we do loans, 17% of our loans every year, over 500 loans are for registrations so that people can bill smooth. And I know your colleague in the room, Sandy's had a crack at this. Many people have had there's almost a seems to be universal agreement. Is this something we should do as Tasmania? Because during COVID, with what was happening in emergency relief, a massive bill shock from a $500 rego was tipping people over. There's 7 different bureaucratic changes that need to happen and some system changes to enable it. Everyone says it should happen, it just hasn't happened. And I'm hoping you as Premier might knock a few heads together and help it to happen.
Well, John, thank you for that question. Look, and again, and for the work that you've done with Nils, I know, especially as we pivoted with the schools, some of the work that you did there was enormously valuable. Could I just also say, and would you pass on to your wife, my enormous thanks for the work that they did. That public health team Only a small group, but they went above and beyond and were just fantastic. And so please thank her for me for that. Look, in terms of registration and bill shock, yeah, absolutely, I'm happy to look at it. It comes with a cost to government. There's no that's always been one of the issues, but I'm very happy to look at it because it's something I must admit, as Treasurer, I've asked the relevant Minister for Infrastructure a couple of times since I've been in my role as Treasurer, and we've never quite got there. Hopefully, if I ask as Premier, we might.
Got time for a couple more, I think.
Hi, Premier. Thanks very much for being a part of this, and thanks Taskos for organising all of this, and the cooks and everything, by the way. Look, I represent an organisation, my name is Mike Lazar, and I represent an organisation called TANA, and I believe Mike Gaffney has spoken a couple of times in Parliament about us. The name means Trauma Awareness Network Australia. I basically represent the grassroots of the Northwest at the moment, I'd like to say. Eventually, a greater number than that. We're building membership, but my it's not really a question, but it's more of a thing that a message that we bring to you from our organization that we're very concerned about how we're going to go forward with this community engagement that we speak of so many times this morning. Adrian, wherever she is, I really appreciate everything you had to say in your opening speech this morning. I definitely feel that we're on the same page. I think we all are on the same page here when it comes to realizing the importance of realizing how community together with our own, everyone's lived experiences can come to a point where we can understand each other better and we can move forward together. But my biggest thing for me in all my life, I've been an entertainer and I've been a father of four and I engage with people all the time. And I realize the importance of conversation when building trust. And you yourself, I know you realize that because throughout this whole year, you had the same narrative. You knew communication to your people you represented was very important, that you engaged with us constantly, saying the same narrative. We're gonna keep you safe. I know it's tough, but we're gonna keep you safe. And you know, from me being an American originally, I know what it's not when you don't have, when you have poor narratives, that's what you get. And I really, really want to say that. And we all should realize that in our own organizations, that our leaders need to keep the same narrative and make us all feel safe. So thank you for doing that. But I guess getting back to my comment, and I would love you to comment back, is I really feel that we need to go grassroots now. I've worked as a chaplain for 5 years, and I know that the problem is we can help ourselves, we can help our children, even in our schools. But if we have children who go home to parents who don't understand the neuroscience and how trauma can be manifested in all our lives, then we're not going to go anywhere. So I ask you now to please, please consider spending more money, as you are now, at this very moment. Relationships Australia has partnered with a new organization called the Information Hub in Burnie. It's just going to have a big street party in Burnie on the 17th of April. And I've been asked through TANA, that the work for TANA does, we're just going to support this. We're going to be the hands and feet of this thing. I'll be supplying entertainment. But my point is, Relationship Australia got some money, received some money, and so did Information Hub in Burnie through Tim McCarthy. And I really appreciate that. We need to turn this day that we're going to have into a time to be able to connect with people. I'm going to play some music I've got all kinds of angels coming to support that. But the day will be about engaging with people, and I don't have time. I've already taken so much time, but I do want to say to you that it's the grassroots engagement. We can have all these agencies doing all they can, and they're doing, you know, spending lots of money, Headspace, Beyond Blue, and all this for mental health. But if we don't have our communities becoming trauma-informed communities, to be able to and education is the key, is education. And the TANA stands behind the education of it all. If you can help us help educate, I'd like to see more engagement with people, young parents in primary schools, after school, during school, while children are in school, that we can engage with them and let them know the science. With professional people involved, organization of TANA wants to help, and I believe there's lots of small, like St. Vinny's is just opening up a place in Somerset. There's an opening day coming again that specifically been given money so that they can have times, ways to engage. And so I leave that thought with you now. Thank you, Prem. And thank you so much for
all right. I'll take that as a comment, and I might refer to some of Mike Gaffney's speeches. I have heard him mention, in fact, in Tanner before, but certainly in terms of what you're proposing, I think there is an opportunity more broadly for us to rethink the way that we engage. I think we need to. I think more than ever, as I touched on at the start of my speech, in terms of the mental health challenge more broadly, which manifests itself in so many different ways, that right now, as a community, we need to be thinking about how that engagement piece looks, how we can get deep reach into our communities, and it's going to be important that we do so. So look, if you've got any further information you want to send through, get it to my office.
Premier, my name is Rosalind Tierney. I'm past president of the Rotary Club of North Hobart. I'd like to respond to Mark to an extent, because you mentioned mental health, and Adrian mentioned mental health as a great need, and you also asked how do we get deeply into the community. Anybody in the room who hasn't heard of Rotary, have a look, because the Rotary Club has an organisation called Rotary Tasmania Community Care, which has been beautifully supported by the Tasmanian government quietly. But we will be running boots on the ground, and there is another initiative called Are You Bogged Mate? And these are mental health services in the rural community primarily, and they will be promoted very much locally. But be aware of them. And if there's any need, as the Premier has invited you to contact him, but if there's any local need, there are 46 Rotary clubs and 4 Rotaract clubs in your communities, full of people with a heart for service. And we don't only work internationally, we also work locally. So please be aware of that.
Thank you. Thank you everyone for having me. Rosalind, thank you for those comments. As a former Rotarian, in fact, I think I still am probably the worst, what do they call us? What's the fork and spooners? I understand the very good work. David Anir, I think, recently raised with me boots on the ground. Anyway, thanks very much for having me. I hope I haven't bored you, and I look forward to working with you into the future as we move forward. Thank you.
Yeah, I'd just like to close by just saying an enormous thank you to the Premier for attending today.